Welcome everyone, I'm Shadow Rider. This is a video within a series building up towards the tourney in the Vale. This will be the first big plot point within the story of Sansa Stark, or Alayne Stone, within the Winds of Winter. In the previous video, we discussed the external politics within the Vale. As you can see in this picture, there are quite a lot of houses opposing Littlefinger, and Littlefinger has to find some way to deal with them. That is what this series will be about. To watch this specific video, you don't need to have watched other videos, though I would recommend it going forward. Oh, and one more thing before the video starts. You can expect spoilers for the books and possible spoilers for the Winds of Winter. Having had all that out of the way, let's go. So, to start. Littlefinger needs to find a way to deal with the Lords Declarant. There are many ways to do this, but George R. R. Martin has presented one which, I have to say, is truly ingenious. But before we get to the specifics of his plan, let's analyze. How could Littlefinger gain the support of the Lords Declarant? There are many ways to do this, but these are the ways that Littlefinger presents. They die naturally, they are murdered, they are bought, they are befriended. The first two are not enough, because then their heirs would follow them and opposition would probably continue. The second two are unlikely. We are assuming here that befriending means becoming friends by being kind, and not becoming friends by holding their son hostage. In A Song of Ice and Fire, characters really like to stretch the definition of befriending, but today we are narrowing it down to being kind. Oh, and buying someone means just buying someone with money, not with other means. But, of course, these are not the only options. I just presented one of them, holding a hostage. There are many ways characters like to disguise holding a hostage, by warding, squiring, imprisoning, courting, promoting, or any of the other many words you can use as it. But, at the end of the day, it remains the same. You're holding someone's children or someone's family to guarantee their loyalty or to hold power over them. We see this already at the very beginning of A Game of Thrones with Theon Greyjoy. He's being held as a hostage to keep his father at bay. In this case it was warding, but we have many other examples. But you can also take other things and hold them hostage. You can take lands and freedom and some family heirloom or some other precious item, and as long as they see some value in it, you can use it against them. You can also make marriage pacts. The most obvious example of this is, well, Margaery's marriage to Joffrey, and later to Tommen. There are of course also examples within the Vale, most prominently Jon Arryn's marriage to Lysa Arryn, and Iselle Royce's marriage to Michael Redford. Marriages are good for two reasons. Firstly, they are an effective way at proving an alliance between two groups. For example, Jon Arryn's marriage was to prove the alliance between the Vale and the Riverlands. But marriages are also an effective way of taking hostages. If you marry someone, you pretty much take the person you marry as a hostage. Now that Margaery Tyrell has been married to Tommen Baratheon, she can be held as a hostage against the Tyrells if they ever decide to betray the Lannisters, which might happen. But there are other, less honorable ways to gain people's loyalty. Firstly, you can gain people's loyalty by giving them money, as established above. But there are also other things you can give them. You can give them lands, castles, honors, titles, positions, rights, powers, etc, etc, etc. If you can think of it, you can probably give it away. The original Baelish was given his lands, Littlefinger was given Harrenhal, Littlefinger was given the honor of traveling to the Vale in the name of the Lannisters, Littlefinger was given the title of Lord Protector of the Vale, Littlefinger was given the position of Master of Coin, Littlefinger was given the right to appoint men to the positions he pleased, and Littlefinger was given the power to control the Vale for a single year. As you can see, these things are quite common. They are not only used to gain people's loyalty, but also for other means. Probably the most important thing you can give someone is promises. As George R. R. Martin likes to say, words are wind, or to extend it, words are wind that blows the sails of men. Let me explain. Words represent promises here, and wind that blows the sails of men is things that motivate people to do stuff. If you want someone to do something, you can promise them something in return. Be kind and I'll give you sweets. Buy this and you won't be disappointed. Serve me and you'll be knighted, etc, etc. Think about the last time someone wanted you to do something. Did they promise you something? Probably, because promises are really powerful. Why are promises so powerful? Well, if you have some reward and someone else wants that reward, you can say, do this task for me and you'll be rewarded. Because they don't have the reward yet, and because they want the reward, they are quite likely to do the task, hoping to get the reward for their trouble. If you already give the reward beforehand, then what's the point for them of doing the task? They might as well do something else. That is why the promise of getting the reward is extremely powerful. You dangle a prize in front of someone without actually having to sacrifice anything. In A Song of Ice and Fire, these rewards are money, lands, castles, honors, positions, titles, rights, etc., etc. Giving someone a promise of one of these, or several of these, could be a good way to gain someone's loyalty. But promises are also dangerous. As established, words are wind. In this case, that means that words are unreliable. I don't know where this definition comes from, but it's a really common Westerosi statement in the books. I think it has to do with a combination of two ideas. Firstly, the idea that winds blow away their promise, and thus that the promise doesn't have to be held, but can also be blown away. It's like a warning of sorts. Watch out, promises are not always fulfilled. And secondly, that promises are empty. Promises alone mean nothing. Just because someone says something doesn't mean they actually mean it. You need a sort of reassurance to trust in someone's promise. This can be done in many forms, but to keep it simple, promises are not enough. You need something else to hold the promise down, or else it blows away with the wind and it means nothing. So, if Littlefinger wants to make a promise, which he probably will, it will probably be the most effective way to gain someone's loyalty. But to make the promise, you will probably need to sacrifice something or do something beforehand or something of the sorts to be able to convince them that he will keep his end of the bargain. Words are wind. Now, to make this clear, these are not the only interpretations of words are wind. To be honest, I think there are almost endless ways to interpret this phrase. And to be clear, I think this statement will become quite important in the upcoming books, though probably not solely through Littlefinger. Oh, and one more thing. Promises don't always have to be positive. You can also say, I promise that if you do this, I will punish you. Promises can also be negative, or in other words, a threat. And promises don't always have to be strictly positive or negative. They can be somewhere in between, but you get my point. The next way you could gain someone's loyalty, though I do think it's extremely unlikely for Littlefinger, is by persuading them of your cause. This could be by saying that you are right and they are wrong. If there is some argument you don't agree on, you could persuade them that you are correct. But it doesn't always have to be some petty argument. You can also persuade people that you have a better claim than someone else, gaining them to your side. Or you could persuade people that you would rule a lot better than someone else, or that something else, because there are so many things people can disagree on. Then, punishments. If someone does something bad, then you can use this against them as a punishment of sorts. This is what happened at the parley. The Lords Declarant brought someone who drew his sword and broke the rules of the parley, and thus, as a punishment, Littlefinger could force his one-year rule on them. This might not seem so important nor so prevalent, but it happens a lot, and it will probably play a huge part in the upcoming tourney. The last way I could think of to gain someone's loyalty is by calling upon their honor. I didn't know for a better term to use for this. What I mean is that you're holding people to their promises. If I promise you something, well, you can expect that I will deliver, and if I don't, you can call upon my honor to do whatever I promised. It's not really a phrase we'd use in present-day society, but it's used a lot in A Song of Ice and Fire. So yeah, let's just roll with it. There are of course many methods that I've either forgotten or chosen not to mention. I can't cover everything. From my knowledge, these are the most important ones, but if I forget anything, I'll be sure to mention it in an upcoming video. Two more important points though. Firstly, information. Information is often really, really important within these types of politics. As they say, words are wind, and a tiny piece of information is sometimes enough to blow entire kingdoms away. I'm just adding it as an important note here at the bottom, though it's not a way to gain loyalties on its own. Secondly, in most situations, it won't just be one of these factors that plays a role, it will probably several. And even though we are going to focus this series mostly on two of these points, it is important to realize that any number of these could be enough for any negotiation. It's just which ones and how many depends on who you're dealing with. That is partly why I made this incredibly long video, so I could explain everything Littlefinger will be thinking about, because he is truly the type of character that thinks about literally everything. Now that we've gone through all that, how can Littlefinger use these different means to gain power over Lords Declarant? What does this have to do with the upcoming tourney? What will Sansa's role be in all this? And then most importantly, what could possibly go wrong? All this and more in the rest of the prophecy videos. Hello everyone, thank you so much for watching, I really appreciate it. If you have other ideas on how to gain power over someone, leave them in the comments below. I'm really interested in seeing what you guys come up with. If you enjoyed the video, feel free to leave a like. If you didn't enjoy the video, feel free to leave a dislike. If you want to see more, feel free to subscribe. Thank you so much for watching. Have a great day. Oh, and one more thing before I leave you. I know that some attentive watchers out there might have been thinking, oh, but this isn't prophecy. You didn't make any predictions of the future. And yes, you'd actually be correct. But I didn't actually discuss writing nor the past. So this video is the type of video that fits somewhere in the gray space between lore and prophecy. And personally, I'd put it closer to lore, but that's my opinion. In this case, it fit a lot better to put it in my prophecy slot, so that's what I did, but you could also expect this types of videos within lore.